Welcome everybody to the IDC Forum Insight Series discussion. This one is on the report released recently by the International Panel on Climate Change. It's a report which has been described by the UN Secretary General as a code red, and it certainly sounds some dire warnings. The real question which we need to ask ourselves is, can we still avoid total disaster? And how can we do this? Now, we're really fortunate this afternoon to have as our guest, Professor Will Steffen. Now, Will is a climate change expert and a researcher at the Australian National University, Canberra. He was on the panel of experts supporting the Multi-Party Climate Change Committee. He served as a science advisor to the Australian Department of Climate Change and Energy Efficiency, and was chair of the Antarctic Science Advisory Committee. From 1998 to 2004, Professor Steffen served as executive director of the International Geosphere Biosphere Program, an international network of scientists studying global environmental change. So it's a field in which he's been involved in for a long time. Will has been active on climate change policy and its interface with science, in fact, for over three decades. And he's played a leading role in developing thinking in this area. He's the author of numerous publications on climate science and was a reviewer to five of the IPCC reports which came out between 2000 and 2018. So welcome this afternoon, Will Steffen. Thank you for joining us. And as I invite you to make some comments to lead off our discussion, I really invite you to not only tell us your perspective on some of the key issues arising out of the report, but also how does this report differ from the previous ones? We've had previous warnings. This again is a very serious warning. What's different now and what can we do about it? Will Steffen.
Okay, thank you very much, Matt. I'm going to use a PowerPoint, so I'll try the share screen now. It should be working. There we go. And okay. Right, you should see the title slide now to begin with. So I'm going to present an overview of the IPCC Sixth Assessment Report Working Group 1, what the main outcomes lessons of that are, and I'll finish with what that means for us in terms of how we have to meet this challenge of climate change. I'll start right with the key findings, and I think these tell you why this is different from the previous reports. For example, the long-term perspective of what's happening, the scale and pace at which we are changing the climate system has almost no precedent in the long record of Earth history. And that includes melting ice sheets, acidifying oceans, shifting rainfall zones, rising sea levels, temperature rise. These are now changing at extraordinary rates from a long-term Earth system perspective. And these impacts and climate change itself are actually accelerating. The rate at which they're occurring itself is increasing. This includes heat waves, both on land and in the ocean, fire weather, as we experienced here in Australia a couple of years ago, storms, heavy rainfall, and so on. This is a third one is an interesting one because worsening impacts are already baked in. In other words, we're going to see worse conditions for at least the next two decades, even if we start getting our emissions down rapidly. That's due to ongoing emissions, even as we decrease them, plus inertia in the climate system. And I think this is number four, something that differentiated this IPCC report from previous ones, is for the first time there was a much greater emphasis on what the IPCC termed catastrophic events, collapse of major ice sheets, rapid temperature spikes, and so on. And they took the view that this is a risk that needs to be taken seriously. They cannot be ruled out and should be part of any risk assessment. So the code red terminology that the Secretary General of the UN used is quite appropriate for what is actually in this report. Well, this is what some of the data look like. That panel on the right shows the global average surface temperature since the mid 20th century, or more from about 1960s, 70s, it's been going up at an increasing rate. It sits now at about 1.2 degrees above pre-industrial, which was the 1850 to 1900 average. Or if you average the temperature over the last decade, it's about 1.1 above that long-term average. I'm going to show you a larger version of this panel on the left because this is quite striking. This is what it's representing. This is a 2000 year temperature record. So this goes back to the time of the Roman Empire in terms of European history. And you can see that the long-term climate does show variability, but within an extremely tight window, no more than one or at most 0.2 of a degree. And it's very, very gentle in terms of its rate over 2000 years. This spike on the right-hand side is the human influence. This is the greenhouse gas driven increase in temperature. So I mentioned it's now sitting at about 1.2 degrees above the pre-industrial average. And so when you look at this in a long-term perspective, you can understand why we're getting extraordinary fires, why ecosystems are degenerating fast, why animals and other parts of the natural world cannot cope with change this fast. And indeed, human societies are now struggling with coping with change this fast. It is outside the norm for many, many thousands and tens of thousands of years. So these rates of change that we're looking at now, CO2 is increasing in the atmosphere over the past two decades. That's about 100 times the maximum rate during the last time CO2 went up rapidly, which is when the Earth came out of the last ice age about 20,000 years ago. The last half century, the temperature is rising at a rate of about 200 times the background rate over the past 7,000 years of the Holocene. These two rates are almost unprecedented in the entire history of Earth, 4.5 billion years, according to the Geological Society of London. The only other time we know for certain that temperatures rose this fast or faster was when the meteorite hit Earth 66 million years ago and wiped out the dinosaurs. That, of course, was a drop in temperature, not an increase, but it was exceptionally rapid. Getting back to the IPCC report, they break down what is driving temperature increase. Two points I want to make. I don't want to go into any great detail here. One is that aerosol cooling, that is air pollution, actually scatters incoming sunlight and cools the planet. That amounts to about 0.4 of a degree. So without that, we would already today be at 1.5. In other words, the greenhouse gases we have already emitted commit the Earth to 1.5 degrees of warming. We're at 1.1 because of the cooling effect of aerosols. The second point I want to make is when you look at the warming over the last decade, in other words, 2010 to 2019, what you find is this bar here represents carbon dioxide, this orange bar on the left, but the next one is methane. So in a short time frame, methane is exceptionally important. It causes about 67% of the warming caused by CO2. Methane emissions have grown rapidly over the last decade. They were fairly steady on the decade before that. The main sources of methane emissions are agriculture, mainly cattle production, also wet rice production, but increasingly fossil fuels, coal, but primarily now with the expansion of gas. And this is a deadly gas because it's very much more potent on a per molecule basis than carbon dioxide. It has a short lifetime in the atmosphere, but over a decadal or a couple of decadal time frame is an exceptionally important driver of climate change. The upside of this is if we can get methane emissions down rapidly, it will have a faster emission, a faster impact on the climate than reduction of CO2 emissions. So keep your eye on methane. It's a very important gas over the next decade or two. The IPCC then projects future emissions, and they use what are so-called scenarios, and they are socioeconomic storylines that tell us what we might do as humans over the rest of this century. And they range from very quick and deep emission reductions, the so-called low emission ones, to intermediate emissions, and then to a very high emission, going up to two or three times what we are emitting today. And not surprisingly, the temperature rise is projected for 2100, a scale according to the emissions. In other words, human emissions are going to be the dominant factor in driving changes in the climate system over the next century. But if we look, I think, at what temperatures are projected to be, I should add here, this really very deep emission reduction plus huge drawdown of CO2 in the second half of the century is actually designed to meet 1.5 degree temperature goal. And most scientists think that that is probably no longer accessible. It would take an extraordinary effort to be able to do that. But probably an easier way to look at where temperature is headed is to look at a table. So basically, this table goes from low emissions at the top of these rows to high emissions at the bottom. And we look at three time periods. One is the next couple of decades, then we look at mid-century, and then we look toward the ends of the century. But I want to make a couple of points here. One is every scenario from the lowest to the highest hits 1.5 within the next two decades. And that's the best estimate from these climate models. So that is telling us we are pretty much already committed to breaching the lower of the Paris climate goals. And when you get to mid-century, all of them, even the lowest, are actually above 1.5. So we have to prepare for the impacts that are associated with 1.5 degrees. And this again goes back to that point we made earlier that worse conditions are already baked into the system. We won't avoid 1.5. Toward the end of the century, there is then a growing and very large difference between the lowest scenario where the temperature actually drops a couple tenths of a degree due to drawdown of CO2 in the atmosphere. But the other ones all continue to rise anywhere from 1.8, which is roughly equivalent to the upper Paris goal, and then much higher temperatures depending on how much more we emit. So where do we stand today as to where we might go into the future? The pledges that countries are making now, and many of these are net zero by 2050, would take you to somewhere around 2 degrees or 2.3, 2.4 degrees. So they're still higher than the Paris goals, but current policies don't match the pledges that governments are making. Current policies would take us to 2.7 or even close to 3 degrees, which is extremely dangerous territory. So we need to ratchet up policies beyond the net zero by 2050 very quickly. Once you get into this area of 2.5, 3 degrees warming or above, there's a real risk that so-called feedbacks in the Earth system might kick in. This is melting permafrost, disintegration of some of the big polar ice sheets and so on, which would basically take the climate system out of our control. So these are very dangerous levels, approaching 3 degrees above pre-industrial and beyond. At present, we're heading for that level under current policies. We have to really move much more quickly, which is one of the key messages of the AR6. One of the features of this particular IPCC report, is that they put projections out for specific continents around the planet. So I'll go through here briefly what the projections are for our future. And this is out toward the middle of the century. And I use the wording that the IPCC used here directly. Intensity, frequency, and duration of fire weather will increase. Heat waves will become more frequent and more intense, and there will be a further increase in marine heat waves and ocean acidity. This means that, of course, we need to prepare for much hotter conditions even than what we've experienced. And the prognosis for the Great Barrier Reef is dismal. Already about 50% of the hard corals have been killed by heat waves, and that's going to worsen. So the best hope there is that we can save remnants of the reef and stabilize the climate as quickly as we can. But we won't save a major portion of the reef. Further increases in droughts in the southern and eastern parts of Australia, and particularly in the southwest. And that's referring to Southwest WA, which is already experiencing a significant drop off in their cool season rainfall. Sandstorms and dust storms are projected to increase throughout the country as we go forward. Increase in heavy rainfall in the northern, central, and eastern parts of Australia. This is talking about mainly the Northern Territory and down the Queensland coast and into northern New South Wales. And the last one, sea levels are rising faster than the global average around Australia. And that combined with increasing storm surges will lead to increasing coastal flooding and shoreline retreat. So these are already baked into the climate system. All of these projections, the IPCC with high certainty says will happen by the middle of the century. So the overall summary, what the AR6 says, this is a summary that was put together by Simon Bradshaw. He's the head of research with the Climate Council. And I think this is an accurate summary from a scientific point of view. This is the most important climate science update for almost a decade. It pulls together all the science we've been doing. It does show there is a narrow path to avoiding catastrophic climate change, but only through immediate, deep, and sustained emission reductions. In other words, this path is indeed in narrowing, and I would say it's also disappearing fast if we don't get our act together. And this may be the final warning from the IPCC. In other words, the next assessment report, the seventh one, may be it's time to batten down the hatches and cope the best we can with what we can't avoid. So that's a very important message. There isn't much time left to avoid a really catastrophic climate outcome. Already, climate change is wreaking havoc around the world with worse to come. We've already mentioned that. But our decisions this decade, and the emphasis is this decade, not 2050, this decade, will be the difference between a livable future for our young people today or a future that is incompatible with well-functioning human societies. And that's a pretty sober message, but it's accurate according to the science. And so the bottom line is every choice we make now and every fraction of a degree of avoided warming actually is important. The right choices will be measured in lives, livelihoods, species, and ecosystems saved. So the bottom line, entire bottom line of this report is strong action now is essential for the future of our children and grandchildren. So that's basically what the AR6 is telling us. This report of the IPCC will be followed by two other major assessment reports in the AR6 portfolio. One is on the impacts and risks of what this climate science is telling us. And the third one will be on mitigation approaches. How do we get onto this narrow and rapidly disappearing path to avoid a really bad outcome? So what is required to meet this challenge? We've done a lot of work at the Climate Council, and there's been a lot of work done by many other groups around the world. Globally, no new coal, oil, or gas developments can be allowed. We've got to get emissions going down basically immediately. 50% emission reduction by 2030, and that's on a 2005 baseline, and net zero emissions by 2040. 2050 is just going to be too late if you want to keep temperatures to well below 2 degrees. For Australia, we're actually proposing we go harder and we go faster. Again, no new coal, oil, or gas developments. And I reiterate that, no new gas developments. So a gas-led recovery is out of the question if we're serious about dealing with a climate change challenge. We're arguing here we could go for a 75% emission reduction by 2030 on a 2005 baseline and could hit net zero by 2035. That's a big ask, but it's possible. And I think it's necessary for two reasons. One is we have been a laggard on climate change. We're lagging behind what our European colleagues are doing and we need to play catch up. The second thing is of all the OECD countries, we have the best renewable resources available to us. And we have a massive potential for export of clean hydrogen, green hydrogen, and other renewably generated products and electricity. So we have enormous opportunities more than most of our colleagues, and we have to play catch up, which is why we are recommending that we have quite ambitious goals. This is what these emission reduction pathways look like. This is some work done by Christiana Figueres, former secretary to the UN FCCC. And this is looking at the peaking year for emissions. And the point I want to make here is that 2020 is basically where we are. So this orange year, this yellow line is the global emission pathway that we could follow. And this is just what we've mentioned here. This is hitting a 50% reduction by 2030 and a net zero by 2040. But the key point is that we have to start emissions going down now, not by 2023, not by 2024 or 2025, now. So this is why the students and others are saying this is a climate emergency. We have really run out of time to talk about things. We actually need to get action underway if we have to meet the Paris targets. This is the challenge we face. These are the actual observed emissions, the observed emission trajectory from 1850 up until about 2019. So these are the total emissions in billions of tons of CO2 globally from both fossil fuels and land use. And you can see that this curve sweeps upwards. It's an exponential growth curve at about a 1.65% increase per year as we go forward. A couple of points to make here. We scientists have done a number of assessment reports starting here all the way up to the sixth assessment here. There are agreements in place internationally. First one was the Kyoto Protocol. Now we have the Paris Agreement. None of this has made any dent in the emission curve. It continues to sweep upwards. So clearly what we've done in the past is not working. The point I want to make though is looking to the future, how challenging this actually is. So a 50% reduction by 2030, here is 2030, that looks like that in terms of a pathway. And that really means we need to put economies on an emergency footing to be able to deliver this much emission reduction this fast. So my final comment is, we really are at the fork in the road now. If we do want a livable future for our children and grandchildren, we actually have to act now. We can't wait. Even 3 or 4 years of delay is deadly. It just puts us so far behind that we will not keep a temperature rise to below 2 degrees. So this is sobering, it's challenging, we can still do it, but we really have to go hard and go fast. That is why the Secretary General of the UN said the AR6 is really a code red report. We've run out of time, we have to act now. So that's my message. I'll stop now and stop screen sharing. Matt, I'll turn it over to you for a discussion.
Thank you very much, Professor Will Steffen. You've certainly given us a very grim and sobering picture, and also outlined some of the challenges and the challenges which have to be taken up at a global level, at a national level, and at an individual level. And the information provided in the IPCC report, and which you've presented, give us a basis for understanding what are the challenges and what do we do about it.